Hey everyone, it's Jenna Melanson from Canadian Beats Media, and it's time for our third episode of Inside the Industry. I'm joined today by Danny Payne from Raison d'Etre Media and the Pressure Drop Show. Welcome, Danny.
I'm going to congratulate you on your pronunciation of raison d'etre. Very good. Hi, how's it going, Jenna?
Good, and you?
Yeah, all right, thank you. Thanks for having me on.
So we're going to get right into the questions. So you're no stranger to the music industry as your co-owner of Raison d'Etre Media, as well as the host of the Pressure Drop Show on CJLO. Tell us a bit about the journey of how you got here, where you are today, business-wise and location-wise.
Wow, that's two long stories. I'll try and keep them reasonably short. But I started working at a record label in London in the early 2000s, like in 2000, actually. But before that, even I was doing PR as almost like a hobby. I was working with bands and putting club nights on and promoting live music nights in Brighton, where I'm from. And I was kind of writing press releases and contacting local media without realizing that what I was doing was PR. And it was just that I loved doing it and I was enjoying it. That, you know, no one was making any money out of it or whatever, but it was just a really fun thing to be doing in sort of late teens, early 20s. And then I heard about a job, moved to London in 2000, heard about a job in a record label that was PR, and it looked like something that I thought, oh wow, my experience fits. And you know, worked for not a lot of money and worked your way up, and you know, the rest is history, really. That's over 20 years in PR in the music industry. I mean, there was a funny time where you know 2008, 2007, 8 or whatever, when we had the big financial crash. That was a tough time for music because at that point the industry was still struggling with how to handle free downloading and all these stuff that it wasn't prepared for. So it was already financially in a bit of a situation. And then the financial crash happened and the music industry really suffered, especially in London. So that at that point was where I sort of diversified into different arts and culture, et cetera, and didn't just specialize in music. So now, you know, Raison d'Etre Media, we work with all kinds of arts, from exhibitions to theater to, you know, festivals and events mainly, but all kinds of amazing things that we work with. So that was where the diversification happened. And here we are now, 2022, Raison d'Etre Media still going in Montreal. So yeah, obviously I've said Brighton, London, now Montreal. You know, I moved here 2010. My wife's actually from here. We lived in London for a few years and decided to give it a go. So that was a strange choice for a PR guy who has no contacts and can't speak the language. Decided to move somewhere. So it was an interesting welcome to Montreal, but it's, you know, 12 years in and I love the place. It's got such a buzzing scene, great music, great culture, and really happy.
When it comes to your publicity, you work with a lot of festivals in Quebec, such as Shazam Fest and FME for Raison d'Etre Media, and Oshaga as a freelance publicist. Although you don't have any part of the booking process, do you have any advice for people looking to play the festival?
Absolutely. I mean, I think something that a lot of artists and bands should realize about festivals is they need some local talent. They need local bands. You know, it's like, on the one hand, they want to give a leg up and say, we want to give our stages to some local artists and support the local scene because it's great for the local ecosystem musically. And also, it's a lot cheaper to fly them in, you know. So in that point, it's also good for the festival as well. That's something bands should realize. It's like, you know, they need you like you need them. It's a two-way street. So make sure you get to know your local festivals. Make sure you get out to the local shows, get to know who the local promoters are, and do that. Get networking and find who's booking these people, who's booking these artists. And once you get to know them, get them, you know, get your music out to them, try and get them to one of your shows. You know, make sure they hear all your news, like you'd send a press release to your local newspaper or local blogs, etc. Make sure you keep the industry side of things aware of your music and new releases and what you've got coming up, that kind of thing. Because it's quite tricky. I always find it's quite tricky. There's a reason why PR guys like me get work. It's because it's quite tricky bragging about yourself. It's quite tricky. So, it's hard, right? Even with, you've got your great website and what you do, and I'm sure you find it easier
Yes,
to
I
talk
do.
about the artists and people you work with than yourself. And so you've got to kind of get over that shyness and say, well, actually, we just played in front of 250 people when we played in Halifax or played in Montreal or whatever. We just did this. We just released that. We've hit 10,000 streams of our latest EP, et cetera, et cetera. Make sure that these people know that, you're getting numbers, you're doing well, whatever at the stage you're at, make sure they hear about what you're doing because it's of interest to them as well. So, although I'm not booking festivals, et cetera, I've worked with enough to know, how these processes work. And I think bands would be surprised at how many opportunities there may be out there for a smaller band that's don't consider themselves, they would be wanted on that bill,
Okay. Awesome. Okay. So you've been hosting the Pressure Drop show for quite some time now. You've chatted with numerous music industry experts, which gives you another unique insight into the industry. With that, plus your own experience, what advice would you give a musician who is looking to develop their brand?
Yeah, again, look, we go back to that, blowing your own trumpet, boasting about your achievements, et cetera. But it's specifically for artists reaching out to me. I like to see simplicity in a message, like because for my radio show, I get so many emails. And this is just a college radio show, CJLO Radio here in Montreal, the Pressure Drop. So you can only imagine what the review editor at Pitchfork's getting, or Canadian Beats are receiving every day. It must, the inboxes must be absolutely slammed. So think about it from that point of view. The person that's looking at this email has got an absolutely packed inbox, very minimal amount of time to, if they open that press release, if they open that email, to click around, to look at what you've written, to listen to what you've sent. So think about the person clicking that email, clicking open, has 30 seconds, and you need to get their attention. You need a great subject. You need to make sure that you've got a link at the top of the page for them to quickly listen to a song, a good description underneath if they're like, okay, this is interesting. What's more, just keep it nice and simple. Again, talk about what's great. That if there's a few bullet points you can put in about, again, streams you've hit or amazing things, or you've been lucky enough to play at one of these festivals, and you have a photograph or so of you on stage at Oceaga or FME or whatever. Just little things to make people think, oh, there's a bit of heat around this band, like, okay, they've got a bit of a buzz, maybe a press quote from the local blog or a newspaper that's covered you, or a radio show that's interviewed you, or ever, little things like that that just make you stand out from the crowd of 2,000 unopened emails. I love the way you're nodding about this, like, oh yes, but something that makes you just jump out a little bit, that gives them a bit more of a, I'm going to give this a listen. Yeah, I'm going to click. And again, that they're going to listen to 20 seconds, 25 seconds of that first song. So make sure that that first song that they click is one that, really, really hits their attention. But yeah, and also, let's face it, have great songs.
Well,
None of this is important without you recording some really good tunes and making sure that, they're well produced, and people can listen to them nice and easily. And that's it. So, songwriting and working on your craft and getting out there and gigging and making sure that your live set is tight, and all those things. Don't get too caught up in the press releases and the blah 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 before you've got the most important thing sorted, which is your music.
yeah, I agree. If a musician is looking to get their music heard on your Pressure Drop show, what is the process that they should take?
Well, just send us an email. You know, we listen to everything. We listen to it. We can't guarantee we play everything because we've got a weekly show. In fact, I was saying to I was speaking with the FME bookers actually from Muffland on my show a few weeks ago, and we were agreeing that okay, we're coming at it from different sides, but the hardest thing about my radio show is the bands or the artists that I can't play because I don't have time. And they were talking about it's a similar vibe on festival lineups because they don't have the space, but etc. And it's frustrating, but we do listen to everything. If we like it and we got space, we play it. We don't care what genre. You know, we believe there's two kinds of music, good and bad. That's it. We just play what we like. So it doesn't, you know, whatever world you come from, whether you're signed, unsigned, your folk music to electronica, whatever. That so long as we like the tune and we have the space, we'll play it. Send us the email, just pressuredropshow@gmail.com, or give us a little nudge on Twitter or whatever it is. We'll always ask you to send tunes to our, you know, the pressuredropshow@gmail.com, and we listen to everything in that inbox.
Okay.
And if we like you and we got the space, we will play it.
What are the benefits of getting played on college or campus radio as opposed to commercial radio?
Well, that's a great question, actually, because we recently had, in fact, during the pandemic, when it, well, during the peak of the pandemic, we're still in a pandemic, of course. I got a few emails from people saying how important the college radio scene was for them while they couldn't tour, while their bands couldn't get out there and gig and doing the etc. It was an essential promotional tool for the smaller labels and the independent labels, smaller bands, etc. And you know, getting those sort of emails, it's really, and I'm sure you get plenty of them yourself about, you know, it, what you do makes a real difference to these bands' careers or this label's output, etc. But the thing, I think the difference with, you know, what we would do to say a bigger sort of commercial station is people do what we do for love. Straight away, there's no need to sell advertising, or we don't have to worry about playing the latest hit to make sure people listen so we can sell more advertising and sponsorship, etc. This is real fans doing something out of love to support our musical ecosystem, to support the industry. And I feel like there's an attention on, if I like an artist, I will keep an eye out for them and I'll try and push them as much as possible. If I like a la or a label or whatever company it is that I'm like, you know, they're on our wavelength, and we always find good tunes from etc. We'll stick with them. It wouldn't have to be like a hit and then we ignore it and then flash in the pan sort of stuff. You know, there's a real support system going on out there, and we're one show of hundreds across the country. And if you know, if you get on our show, I hope you're getting on the other Montreal college radio stations. And I hope you're getting on the, you know, even the Francophones, the Anglophones. I hope they're going out to Ottawa University, Toronto. You know, if you get in that ecosystem, you get a lot of passionate people who are there to support you, who will buy a ticket for your show. Or, you know, if you're nice enough to put them on the guest list, then they'll spend that ticket money at the merch stand and make sure they come away with a record or a t-shirt. Because also, because we're fans, we recognize that buying a t-shirt or two or buying the vinyl, that's petrol money to your next show, right? You know, that's we're just always putting into the sort of the circle, if you like, and making sure that we look after those that come through into town or releasing albums or EPs or whatever, have that support. Because once you've got onto the college radios scene, again, as I was saying about when people promote themselves and talk about what they've done, when they go to the commercial stations and they say, right, we've been on rotation at CJLO, CKUT, CIUT. Once the commercial radio stations hear that, oh, well, okay, they've been on solid rotation in the college scene or the community radio scene, there's a little bit of heat there that they say, okay, maybe we'll take a chance, maybe we'll play this band, because it's the foundations, right? So we're like the sort of first major step on a ladder for an up and coming band to get out to a wider audience.
And what would you say makes the Pressure Drop show and I knew I'd screw it up. What makes the Pressure Drop show and Raison d'Etre Media stand out?
Oh wow. Well, in terms of, the Pressure Drop show, I think the sort of multi-genre thing is definitely a big one, because obviously a lot of things are geared towards metal or geared towards hip hop or a specific genre, where we cross the board, we concentrate mainly on new music, but we also sort of respect the classics. So if there's a reissue coming out of a sort of unsung Afrobeat originator or something, we'll spin that as well and try and link, and we'll try and link the two things together, saying maybe the newer artists have taken a bit of inspiration from the sort of the older artist, if you like. So there's certainly that, where we try and cross the divide, and as well as crossing genre. But in terms of Raison d'Etre Media, we work exclusively with people we love. There is not one client of ours that we would take on just for the money or just to work on the cash. And I think in terms of PR, it's so important, because if people get an idea that you just do projects that you don't really care about, you're not that into, why are they going to believe your word to say, hey, you should write about this or you need to cover this? Everyone that receives a press release from us, everybody that receives a picture from us, everybody that receives a phone call from us knows that they are our clients, because we love them. And to work with them, it's just an absolute honor. It's an absolute pleasure. And so I think that authenticity, and I'm not saying other places aren't like that or whatever, I don't know how other people work, but I'm just saying from my point of view, I think that's the most essential ingredient of Raison d'Etre Media. Because, because it's we spend a lot of time working. I don't want to I'm not going to work PR on somebody I'm not absolutely 100% in love with, and respect, and want to wake up in the morning and look forward to working on that project, So, there are two things, but I could probably bore you for hours about that. So I'll use one example from both and keep it reasonably succinct.
Okay. Well, thank you for joining me, and I hope to do this again sometime.
Any time, Jenna. Honestly, it's always lovely to chat with you and chat about what we get up to over here in Montreal.